So, good day. My name is Laptev Alexander, and today I will tell you a bit about quantum computing. Unfortunately, we are late a bit. Dylan took our time. So, probably we will leave to lunch a bit later than expected. Okay, so the quantum computing. The quantum computing is a fashion, but not hyped area right now. Probably because of its complexity. There are a few areas of it. We will talk today about the universal quantum computers. I will try to make a short overview. What is this? Why is it work and when it doesn't work? They will be part of math, physics, but I will try to avoid most of formulas. If you know what is Shor's algorithm or know how to correct errors on the qubits, probably with this talk will be almost useless for you. So, quantum computing consists of three main areas. The first one is a math. Math is split into two particles again. The first one is a domain. That's algorithms over theory numbers, cryptography, security, random, and stuff like this. Usually it's done by the scientists in MIT, Stanford, and universities like this. Another part is math minimum, which is required for the standard quantum engineer. That's a bit of complex numbers and a bit of matrix multiplication. If you don't know such kind of math, don't worry, we will try to avoid it today. The second part of quantum computing is physics. Physics gives us real chips which work over the quantum effects. They can work with a temperature near the absolute zeros. And if you know physics too well, I will not touch it today. Everything I will do, I will just describe the effects and characteristics of the real chips without details of the implementation. The last part is production. This part is the smallest one because there is no production-ready programs yet. So we will obviously skip it. So in short, we will take a look at the history, then define what is the quantum supremacy and is it achieved or not. Describe the problems of physical implementations of quantum computers, and then decide if we need this area or not. The history of quantum computers starts from the Richard Feynman. It was a famous physicist. He enriched the uranium in Los Alamos, one of the authors of the atomic bomb. He wrote a cool autobiography. And he liked to visit the strip clubs. When he was aged in 1984, he suggested a brave idea that as simulation of the quantum effects is too difficult on the classical computers, we have to build an analog machine for computations. This idea was brave because years ago, other scientists demonstrated that classical computers can beat analog machines almost in all areas. So in this moment, this guy went in front of the flow of the science of that time. In any case, he was well-known, so people tried to hear him. And everything was started from the qubit. That was a basic of quantum computing, and it is the basic of the quantum computing right now. Qubit is an element which is similar to the classical bit. It can take the values like 0 and 1 and keep them. Of course, it's always built over the physical cells. And if you know the physical cells of standard computers, for instance, for RAM, you know about the energy leak. If you have a standard bit, it has some energy state. And it's not always 0 or 1. It can be 0.01 or 0.02. Or vice versa, it can be 0.99 or 0.98. In fact, with a bit, everything is simple. Everything which is more than 0.5 is considered as 1, roughly say. Everything which is below the 0.5 is considered as a 0. Qubit is a bit more difficult cell. Usually, it's visualized as a sphere. And the state of the qubit is demonstrated by the point on this sphere. If the state is on the North Pole, qubit keeps the zero. And if the state is on the South Pole, the qubit keeps the one. In fact, you can use qubits in your memories, in your RAM, and probably not. Only in the RAM, and build a full computer over it. It will be expensive, it will cost billions of dollars, but if you have it, you can. The most interesting part of the qubit is a superposition. It happens when the state of the qubit described on the any point on the surface of this sphere, here, 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 or here, doesn't matter. In this case, on the qubit measurement, we don't know which exactly result we will get after the reading the qubit, after its measurement. For instance, if we have a state somewhere on the equator, we can take 100 qubits, set them into this state, measure all of them, and we will get roughly, say, 50 zeros or 50 ones. Or maybe we will measure 0 49 times, and we will measure 9 51 times. In fact, even in this point, we can extract some profit, because we already have a source of random. Different programs, different algorithms has their own approach to get random. Some of them ask to move mouse randomly from user. Some of them use time. Random.org used radio waves in the atmosphere. With a single qubit, you don't need it. You get a random just by the power of universe. Also, this random is not only 50-50 probabilities. If you use a state somewhere here, you may get a probability 25 over 75%, or 60 versus 40, or 24, 80. You can set up any probabilities that you want. Unfortunately, this sphere, it doesn't a convenient instrument to describe the state of the qubit. Imagine that you say, yes, you want to say your neighbor, hey, please set your qubit into this state. And your neighbor will ask you, what state is it exactly? So in the numeric form, every qubit is described by two parameters, alpha and beta. And zero can be measured over qubit with a probability of model of alpha square. And the one can be measured with the probability of module of the beta square. Probably states like 25-75, 50-50, 0-100 could be a bit more simple. But due to the physical limitations, due to the physical nature of qubits, we have to use alpha and beta parameters, which belongs to the complex numbers. This state, when both values could be measured with the sum probabilities, is called a superposition. And the obvious rule is that sum of probabilities to measure 0 or 1 is 100%. We cannot measure 2, we cannot measure p, we cannot measure 42. It's always 0 or 1. There is another consequence from this rule. Qubit is always a black box. Even if we have 100 qubits, and we set it up into the same superposition, but we don't know which exactly, we measure it, and we don't know what the original state of the qubit was. Imagine that we again took 100 qubits, measured them, got a 50 and 50 zeros and ones. Everything we can say from it is that it's just a point somewhere on the equator, and nothing more. Of course, random is a great thing, but usually for algorithms, we want to modify our data somehow. There is an infinite number of operations over the qubit, but usually we use only a few of them. Most popular are X, which transforms alpha and beta parameters to beta and alpha. Z, which is pretty simple, is just transforms beta to minus beta. And Adamar. X operator is interesting because it reverses the probabilities of measuring 0 and 1. So if we have a qubit with the states 25 over 75, we apply the X operator, it gives us probabilities 75 and 25. Z operator doesn't change the probabilities of measurement of 0 or 1 anyhow, and it's more a service one. And Hadamard gate is the most popular with a not so simple formula. In fact, usually it's used to convert the 0 state to the balanced 50-50. And the one state to the another balanced 50-50. Any operation over qubit has two important requirements. The first one is obvious. Every superposition has to be converted into another valid superposition. We can take any qubit on the any state, apply the any of it operation, and at the end, we have a qubit, which after the measurement will give us either 0 or 1. Another important requirement for the operation is reversible. For the every operation, there is a reverse one, which returns the qubit to the original state. Why is it important? Well, in fact, this is important because we cannot define the standard operations for the classical computers. In the classical computers, we can write something like array 0 is equal to 0, and this will work. But for the qubit, it will not work. If we imagine that there is an operation which sets qubit to 0, we have to have a reverse at 1. And the question is, what will be returned the reversed operation over the 0? 1, 50, 50, 25, 75. We don't know. Operations can be implemented also over a few qubits. In fact, the limitations are the same. Every valid superposition is transformed into another valid superposition. Here I didn't use the alphas and betas and wrote just a simple percentage. And the same rule, every operation over a few qubits is reversible also. These two limitations over operations have a mathematical description, but we will skip it for now. And this effect over operations gives us a base for the quantum parallelism. That's most probably the most important myth, that with the quantum computers we can implement tons of operations in parallel. And in fact, that's half of the truth. We can take the three qubits and get a superposition over the eight elements. Apply a single operation, and all of these eight substates of the superposition will be changed. You can imagine an eight qubits. Eight qubits keep a superposition of the 256 states. 16 qubits keep a superposition of the 65,000 with something states. 32 qubits keep 4 billion substates in the superposition, and one single operation affects all of them. That means that if we have, let's say, 1,024 qubits, we can generate amount of substates, which is more than amount of atoms in our universe, and still we will amend all the states by the single operator. And single operator in quantum computer takes something like nanoseconds. So in nanoseconds, we amend the whole state of the universe. Unfortunately, it doesn't really work in the real world. And the reason is pretty simple. When we measure all these qubits, we will get only the single value. So we can generate a superposition over billions of states, apply the operation, but as the result, we get only one of these substates, and only with a small, small probability. Obviously, as more substates we have, the less probability of each to be measured. That's why quantum parallelism is almost useless itself. To finish the basics of quantum computing, I would mention that not all operations are so simple like this. If you work with a multi-qubit operation, you have to write tons of parameters, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, epsilon, etc. And it's not really simple. If you are a math professional, you can work with matrices. In fact, every operation, it takes any substate and splits it into the superposition. Then you unite all the superpositions, combine them, and get the result. But I think we can just skip it for now. In any case, if you want to start work with it, you will have to multiply a lot of matrix and vectors in future. Much more appropriate, much more simple notation is circuits. That's something you can work it. And in fact, you can work with circuits even online. There will be links at the end. As I told, by technical limitations, we usually use only a few operations. It's X, Z, and their control at variance. And that's why it's more or less simple to describe the programs in blocks on over the circuit. For instance, with a circuit on the slide, we can get a so-called Bell state when both qubits are either both zero or both one. And I think we can work with this circuit a bit. The first one applies the Adamard operation over the top qubit. So our original state 0,0 is transformed to the balanced 0,0 and 0,1. As I told, the Adamard just moves the zero state to the balanced when 0 and 1 probability are measured with the same. When 0 and 1 are measured with the same probability. The next step is a so-called control. Control means that operations over qubit or few qubits may be implemented only for substates when other qubit is in the state 1. So if we take our superposition after the H, after the Hadamard gate, we see that in the one substate, the top qubit is 0, and in the other one, the top qubit is 1. If we applied our controlled X gate, we ignore this substate, because the top qubit is not 1, and it stays the same. But on this substate, the top qubit is 0. And after our controlled reverse, we change this 0 to 1. In fact, most of operations over few qubits are based on this control something operations. And that means that we have only a few main functions in any quantum circuit. Unfortunately, the control is not the best word to describe the effect of the scheme. If you imagine control in the classical computer, we have something like if-then-else statements. If array 0 is equal to 2, then do something with the variable z. But in quantum world, everything is a bit others. For instance, if we take two Adamard gates over the zero state, we will get the zero state at the end. But if we insert the controlled statement in between of two Adamard gates, we will measure the zero only with a 50-50 probabilities. In fact, this operator, it doesn't affect zero somehow. It just uses its value. But in quantum physics, even this affects the controller. David Deutsch used this trick to demonstrate the first sample of the quantum supremacy. He built the fully artificial task, which sounds like we have a function which takes one bit argument and returns the one bit. And we have to reveal if this function is a constant or not, if we have an implementation of this. In the classical computer, we need two measures to define what kind of function do we have. We define the value from 0, define the value from 1. If all of them are the same, we say that this function is constant. Otherwise, it is not constant. In the quantum world, Deutsch suggested that if we set up the qubit to the Adamard and then apply our oracle, our function, If our function is a constant, we don't need to change the bottom qubit somehow. And at the end, we will get the twice Adamar order the top qubit, and we'll get zero. On the other hand, if our function is non-constant, our argument should affect the result somehow, and our probability on the measurement will not be zero. It will be always one. Pretty simple and pretty useless demonstration of the quantum supremacy. And of course, everybody could notice that this is just an artificial function over the single argument, and it provides you, well, speed up just in two times, just useless. Well, Deutsch didn't refuse from his idea, and in 7 years, in 1992, he, with another scientist, provided the next algorithm. This algorithm gave the asymptotical speedup in n times. It was, again, the fully artificial function, and we had to define if it's constant or not. But a classical computer took n measurements, depending on the number of arguments. And the classical computer, again, did everything in the one single operator. After that, there was an intermediate algorithm called Simon 1. We will skip it. And later, the Shor, in 2 years after the Deutsch-Yoja, hacks the numbers factorize. In fact, he solved another problem, which looked period in divisor circles. But as a consequence, he solved the problem of factorizing of large number in polynomial time. And at that point, and at this point, the quantum computing became more or less real. It got the potential, and people start to think, maybe it's time to implement it. That was a kind of revolution, because RSA was and still is the base of the existing cryptography. So half of the society started to think how to implement quantum computers and hack everything, and another half started to think, well, what should we use instead of RSA? They got a post-quantum cryptography, but that's not, unfortunately, a topic of our today's talk. In 2 years later, another scientist, Grover, suggested another algorithm. Roughly say, this algorithm allowed you to hack hashes. So if you know, if you have any hash, and you know that hash of x is equal to 42, and you want to reveal this x, what are you doing? You take all numbers from 0 till the maximum range of x, takes a hash of it, and when the hash is equal to 42, you cry, hey, I'm happy here. Grover went to another way. He built the superposition of all possible values of the argument, and then applied this hash function with additional trick once and once and once more. Well, and at the end, he needed much more or less operation than a classical computer. And although that's two the most famous algorithms, there is one key difference between them. Shor, he found something like a hack or a vulnerability inside the factoring of two numbers. And that's why he got a practically useful algorithm. Grover produced the algorithm which allows you to hack any hash, but this algorithm is optimal, and it's still the exponential. So the complexity is exponential. That means that if we want to hash something in order to be protective to the Grover algorithm, we just took a standard hash, increase the key twice, or decrease or increase the hashed secret twice, and we are in safe. And as it's optimal, we can do anything. In fact, that means that if we want to hack any security or cryptography system, we still cannot rely on the Grover, and we still have to find some vulnerability in the hash. And well, looking such kind of math vulnerabilities, it's not the simplest task in the world, and only thousands of people can do it. Okay, and that was the short description, short overview of the math, and we can make a 2 minutes pause for your questions. Anyone? Generally, I think.
Okay, I'm curious about this breakthrough of Google's supercomputer. So, which happened last month.
Yeah.
They managed to extract some benchmark tasks within 3 minutes or so, which other computers would do thousands of years, right? So what does it exactly mean? Does it mean anything? Can we now crack everything, or just some
We will check the Google's quantum supremacy a bit later at the end of the presentation.
You also mentioned that quantum computer needs to be in a very cool state, right?
No, quantum computers shouldn't work in the very cool state. There are few technologies like superconductors, ion traps, and few of them work with a really low temperatures. And other use another technologies, well, but that's still the edge state of the current physics.
Okay, but is it possible, I saw those cooling systems of quantum computers, right? And is it possible to build quantum computer which will be smaller than this huge thing, Or is it possible because of the temperature limitation?
No, temperature limit is not critical for the quantum computers. In fact, if you want to build a small quantum computer for a few qubits, you can do it manually in your garage. I will send the link to the course later. Yeah? Well, quantum computer has a noise, and we'll consider it a bit later. Any question more? So I think we can continue. So we considered the math state of the quantum computing, and let's go to physics. The physics means that we have a real existing chips which work on the quantum computers. And the first problem is amount of qubits. Well, Bill Gates told us that 640 kilobytes should be enough for everyone. In quantum computing, we right now have only 53 of them. There are highly specialized machines which has 500 qubits, but they work only for few tasks, and the classical computers are limited by 53. IBM promised to twice amount of qubits twice every year. So we have to wait for kind of 10 or 12, 20 years before we will be able to hack RSA for 1,000 bits. Another problem is quantum decoherence. As I told on the real bit, we have a problem that energy leaks from it. And instead of norm of 1, we can have 0.99. In real chip, it's really easy to fix. Everything which is more than 0.5 is ups to 1. But in quantum computing, every qubit is a black box. We don't know the state which it is right now. Even if we know that some error appeared, that's another problem. Quantum decoherence, it's about the time of the execution. Roughly say, we cannot just run algorithm like terminal, then go to smoke or drink or give a talk, and everything will work fine. And after the count, I will come write ls and see something. In quantum computing, it doesn't work because the quantum state is really unstable. And we have only microseconds or sometimes milliseconds to implement all necessary operations. After that, the qubit states is corrupted. They become, they start to self-measure, and at the end, we get a trash. Also, we cannot make a pause to make a backup of the current state, cool the system, and then rerun the algorithm from the saved state, because all qubits are a black box, and we cannot just save it. And on practice, it means that we are really limited in the amount of operations that we can execute. So people try to optimize the circuits, to run a few elements in parallel, to locate qubits near each other, to optimize the circuits in a way when we do as less operations as possible. Another similar problem is errors on gates and measurements. Every time when we execute an operation over qubit, we meet the quantum noise, and in 2% of cases, the qubit is corrupted. So its state is moved or it's self-measured. If we make an operation over 2 qubits, the error rate can achieve the 7%. And in fact, if you just apply 1,000 Adamards for the Grover algorithm, that means that you will corrupt your original state with a probability equal, not equal, but really close to 1. In one of Google papers, engineers wrote that, okay, if we have 100,000 real qubits, we can connect them in a way when most of them just support and correct the errors on the first qubit. So like in Soviet Union, 100 people launched the Yuri Gagarin into the space. Google suggests to do the same. 100,000 qubits support the single qubit for the computation. I thought that IBM promised to double qubits every year and promised you 10 or 20 years for practical usage of the quantum computing. As we need 100,000 qubits, we have to add 15 years in additional. And practical usage is delayed on 25 years. The next problem is connectivity. Connectivity means that we cannot implement all operations that we want. And sorry for this. I just lost my mouse. Is it presentation? Could someone help me? Two downs more. On quantum chips, qubits are not located near each other. Usually, they are located in the one line or onto one square. And in any case, most qubits can interact only with their 6 neighbors. So if you want to apply the standard controller not operator that I demonstrated to you earlier, we cannot just use it. if our qubit sits far away from each other. At first, we have to swap the target qubit to the controller one, apply the operation, and then swap everything back. In the presentation, there is a link with a sample. You will be able to take a look at this. In fact, that means that even if we have an optimal algorithm, due to the connectivity problem between qubits, we have to implement much more operations than necessary. And more operations means that we have more errors, and we meet quantum noise more often, and we have much less time for valuable operations, and we can meet the decoherence. Next point is basic operations. As I told you at the beginning, the three main operations is X, Z, and Adamor. In fact, you can get the Adamor as a combination of X and Z. In the Google Supremacy sample, which happens a month ago, few journalists insulted Google that they used not the operations that were supposed to use. So instead of repeating the classical computer computations, Google engineers added additional operation and get some advantage based on it. In fact, this factor will be important years later. So, like today, we choose our laptops for work, video home, or Bitcoin mining. In 20 years, we will care about basic operations because they will influence the price of a quantum computer. And the last conceptual problem is a debug. Problems at the top are more or less physical, and they can be solved with a technology, but the debug problem is not solvable at all. If you remember the beginning of the presentation with Richard Feynman, who liked strip clubs, he told that we need specific analog machines because we cannot emulate the quantum effects. Again, if we have a superposition over 8 qubits, we have to keep info about 256 substates. If we have a superposition over 16 qubits, we have to keep info about 65,000 substate. If we have 68 qubits, we have to keep info about quadrillions of substates. And the largest emulator that I've read about was 53 qubits. And this emulator took 2 basketball fields. Every additional qubit doubles the requirements for memory. And that's why I even cannot imagine the emulator who emulates the 100 qubit system. And as we are talking about Shor's algorithm over RSA, we have to think about thousands of qubits. And that's not emulatable and it's not debuggable at all. Imagine a situation when you run a quantum algorithm, it doesn't work, and you have no clue if it doesn't work because of decoherence errors or just because your algorithm itself is incorrect. Okay. That was more or less it about the physics and problems. Unfortunately, we were a bit fast due to delay at the beginning. In the materials, you can take a look at the circuits editor online. It allows you to play with the 15 qubits. Few video courses, a link to the Microsoft Q-Sharp language and its environment, link to the Rigetti and Python libraries for quantum computers and simulations, just a popular quantum computer blog, a link to the quantum report. It's the site where the actual info about quantum computers is kept, and a list of quantum algorithms. Mostly it's a pure math, but maybe you will be interested in. I think it's time for your questions or for your lunch. existence is a... No. As I told about the Hodgkin's time, even if we store, everything will be broken in a few milliseconds. So that's not the best place to store something.
So basically, if I want to start some computation, I have to start from the zero.
Like, yeah. We always start every computation from zero to the end or get an errors. Any other questions? So I think we can stop here. Thanks for your attention.